It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. I'd like to run down some of the headlines from yesterday. From the CBC, Liberals stonewalling Ontario's fiscal watchdog. From the Toronto Star, budget watchdog says the Liberals hiding data from him. The Canadian Press, the FAO says Liberals block his access to info. Mr. Speaker, we all know the Liberals don't know how to even spell the words open government, but you think they'd actually be able to practice it. Simple question for the Premier, Mr. Speaker. What are the Liberals hiding from the Financial Accountability Office?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Absolutely nothing. Mr. Speaker, we appreciate the independent and valuable analysis that the FAO does of the state of the province's finances, Mr. Speaker. Ministries continue to meet with the Financial Accountability Officer and his team to share information and answer questions, and we expect ministries to work closely with the Financial Accountability Officer, Mr. Speaker, as is enshrined in the legislation. Government officials have recently reached out to follow up on some of the issues that that the FAO outlined in his press conference yesterday, Mr. Speaker. And as the Minister of Finance said yesterday, there is another government-wide directive going across government, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that offices within the ministries are responding to the FAO in a consistent and a timely manner. I would just remind members opposite, Mr. Speaker, that we are working within legislation that was drafted, and we worked on with the opposition.
Thank you.
Speaker.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier, and the government likes to insist that they're open and transparent, but the FAO would have had to have a press conference to plead for openness and transparency if that was the case. So let me quote the FAO. Stephen Leclerc said yesterday, from day one, the Liberals have claimed cabinet confidences on almost any future projection. There is clearly political interference, and ministries are being directed by the corner office to obstruct and block the FAO. Leclerc added, I believe this is political direction. And based on the Globe and Mail article, we already know the Premier feels that she needs to run all the ministries and pick up their slack. So, Mr. Speaker, my question for the Premier is, will she instruct all the Liberal ministers to be transparent and open, just like you promised?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And just to be clear, requests for information from the Financial Accountability Officer are responded to by nonpartisan officials. I know the members opposite don't want to hear the answer, but
stop the clock, please. I tried to see if you were going to do this on your own, and I think I'll have to help. If it continues, I'll go straight to I'll go straight to warnings and then naming. Keep it down. Carry on, please.
Mr. Speaker, it is not the politicians who respond to the request from the Financial Accountability Officer. It is the officials, Mr. Speaker, who are nonpartisan.
The member from Nipissing and the member from Leeds Grendel, come to order. Minister of Finance, come to order. Premier.
Oh, given that it is nonpartisan officials who respond to the Financial Accountability Officer, Mr. Speaker, I go back to the statement of the Minister of Finance yesterday, which there is a directive going across government to ensure that all of those officials understand that we are operating within legislation.
Answer.
That was put together, Mr. Speaker, as a result of a conversation with the opposition parties in a minority parliament, Mr. Speaker, and is consistent with the parameters of the Parliamentary Budget Officer in the federal government, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, that's clearly not what the FAO said. The FAO said it's political direction that is causing this blocking. You know, the Minister of Finance has said that the Liberals will be sending a government-wide directive to all offices to ensure the offices are responding to the FAO in a consistent and timely manner. But if you do a Google translation changing English into Liberal talking points, what comes up is the government's instructing all ministers to invoke cabinet confidentiality and block the FAO's access as quickly as possible. Wow. You know, this isn't acceptable. You say one thing and the reality and your actions are completely different. Mr. Speaker, will the Premier stop hiding behind confidentiality? Mr. Speaker, you know, if you're not transparent and open, Madam Premier, one of your disgruntled cabinet ministers is going to leak it anyways. Just do the right thing. Be transparent, be open.
Thank you. seated, please. Be seated, please.
You can get yourself in trouble even when I ask you to sit. And I would direct my recommendations to speak to the chair, please. Premier.
Finance.
Sir, finance.
Mr. Speaker, the province of Ontario is the first and only province in Canada that has instituted a financial accountability officer. It's been modeled after the parliamentary budget officer, which the member opposite knows all too well. He's making an accusation, Mr. Speaker, that aren't what Ontario is doing. We have acted in accordance with the legislation that has been passed. It may very well be that in Ottawa.
Member from Dufferin-Caledon, come to order. The member from Leeds-Grenville, second time. Finish, please.
It may well be that in Ottawa, that's how this member operated with his counterparts in regards to the accountability office. It's not what we're doing in Ontario. We've assessed the situation. We want to work collaboratively with the financial accountability officer for the benefit of open and being more transparent in the regards to the work that we do. That's exactly what is happening, Mr. Speaker. We took and heard what the financial accountability officer had to say. We are working with him to ensure he gets the information necessary.
Thank you. No questions. The Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, since the government doesn't want to talk about their culture of secrecy and obstruction, let's talk about something else. Let's talk about the disgruntled cabinet minister that leaked the Globe and Mail a copy of the Climate Change Action Plan. Action number 13 of the leaked cabinet document.
I'm not going to accept that, and if it happens again, the member will be warned. Carry on.
Action number 13 of the leaked cabinet document said, set targets for updating the building codes so that new homes and small buildings built by 2030 are not relying on fossil fuels for heating and cooling. Expand this requirement to all buildings before 2050. Mr. Speaker, will the government be taking this action? Will they be amending the building code to limit natural gas? And if they're not taking this action, are they stating here in the legislature that the document that was leaked to the Globe and Mail entitled Cabinet Confidentiality is actually a falsified document?
Thank you. Premier.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And again, I will say to the member opposite, and I made it clear when I was in Alberta that we are not banning natural gas. We're not doing those things that the member opposite wants to stir up issues around, Mr. Speaker, because he doesn't want to talk about climate change. And as I said yesterday, like his former colleague in Alberta in the Wild Rose Party, Mr. Speaker, he does not want to talk about climate change. He does not want to talk about the reality that we have to tackle this threat to humanity, this threat to the globe, Mr. Speaker, and we have to do it in a responsible way, which is why we will be bringing out the Climate Action Plan, Mr. Speaker. And of course, there are working documents that government uses in the run-up to the release of a plan, Mr. Speaker, and we will be talking more fully about the plan in coming days.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, and I would note that there was no answer on whether that document was accurate. There was no answer whether that document was falsified. And you know, frankly, Mr. Speaker, if I'm going to believe the Premier or the Globe and Mail, well, the Globe and Mail has got a much better track record. You know, in terms of the Hydro One fire sale, it was the Globe and Mail that exposed it. The Minister of Education's secret payouts, it was the Globe and Mail that exposed it. And once again, on the cap and trade plan, it was the Globe and Mail that exposed it. The Liberals say they're not going to ban natural gas, but they can't refute the story in the Globe and Mail. The Liberals claim they're not going to expand natural gas, yet they actually haven't provided a single dollar for that expansion. If the Premier was truly committed to natural gas in Ontario, she'd be spending money to expand it, not simply saying it might happen sometime in the future. Mr. Speaker, when will the Premier actually spend a single dollar to expand natural gas in the province of Ontario?
Thank you. Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much. much, Mr. Speaker. Well, we've been clear that expanding the use of natural gas, and in fact, I used that as the example of and the evidence that we were not interested in banning natural gas, Mr. Speaker. There's $230 million in the budget to expand access to natural gas in our northern and rural communities, Mr. Speaker. The leader of the opposition knows that perfectly well. He also should know that the agriculture community came forward with that specific ask, Mr. Speaker, and made it clear that that was something that needed to happen. We've responded to that, Mr. Speaker. That process is underway, and that expansion will happen. But I think fundamentally, Mr. Speaker, people need to understand that the leader of the opposition wants to talk about process, he wants to talk about distractions, because he does not want to talk about nor support any change that would lead to a reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, Mr. Speaker. He doesn't believe in climate change action, and he's not supportive of the actions that we're...
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The people and businesses of Ontario don't deserve to be strung along.
Right.
Environmental Defence wrote to the Ontario Energy Board asking for the natural gas expansion to be halted because they know that's exactly where the Liberals are headed.
Minister
with
Finance,
so much
second
uncertainty,
time.
No company would pay millions of dollars to expand natural gas only to be told they're no longer going to have customers.
Exactly.
So once again, I'm going to go back to the same question I've asked three times to the Premier. Mr. Speaker, was that document labeled Cabinet Confidential, was that document accurate or is that a falsified document? We would like an answer.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. The member from Renfrew, come to order. Minister of Aboriginal Affairs, come to order. And I'll pick you off one at a time if you. Minister of the Environment, come to order. And now I'm moving to warnings. Thank you. Bring it.
Despite what the opposition says, we're not forcing anyone off natural gas. We announced in 2015 $230 million to expand natural gas for northern and rural communities. Mr. Speaker, this is not a laughing matter. The reality is that climate change is affecting the globe. Climate change is affecting every part of the globe, Mr. Speaker. We have a responsibility to put in place a responsible plan. When that plan is finalized, Mr. Speaker, and it comes into the public realm after it's been through Cabinet, I look forward to the opposition having a reasonable conversation with us, Mr. Speaker, because this is something that will affect all of us, and it will even more profoundly affect our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren, Mr. Speaker. So the opposition party is not interested in taking action on this front. We are. We are moving forward responsibly. We are going to invest in innovation. We are going to develop technology that will be good and used here in Ontario and around the globe, Mr. Speaker.
Thank
we
you.
Think they should be working with us on that.
Thank you. New question. The member from Nickel Belt.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
My question is for the Premier.
Speaker, right here, right now in Ontario, we have hospitals that face the risk of imminent breakdowns. But the Liberal government won't release which hospital need that work. The Premier seems more concerned about avoiding bad PR than she is with giving Ontarians the confidence that their hospitals are being properly maintained. Speaker, this is just one more sign of a healthcare system in crisis. Nurses are being laid off, beds are being closed, and the Minister of Health seems to be making things up as he goes along. When will the Premier finally look at the facts and admit there is a silent crisis in healthcare and it's patients that are paying the price?
Question, answer,
well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And you know, It is very important that we address the deferred maintenance issues in hospitals across the province, but we have to do that in a responsible way, Mr. Speaker. On top of building new hospitals, the $12 billion that is in place, Mr. Speaker, to build new and renovate hospitals, the $100 million a year for deferred maintenance, Mr. Speaker, all of that goes to address the challenges that hospitals face in terms of maintenance. But, Mr. Speaker, that is the reality of having a large set of assets that have to be maintained on a regular basis. Whether it's schools, whether it's hospitals, there needs to be money that on a regular basis is used to address those challenges. That's the reason, Mr. Speaker, that we actually increased the amount of money available to hospitals to tackle that deferred maintenance. Yeah. We're doing that in a responsible way, Mr. Speaker, and I know that we're working closely with the hospitals in order to make those repairs.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, the Health Minister says that he won't tell Ontarians what hospital need maintenance work because, and I quote, it would give contractor an unfair advantage if they knew, in advance of their bid, what the hospital or ministry had estimated the cost. But that's not what the ministry told us. The ministry told us, and again, I quote, concerns are that contractor currently engaged by hospital would lose confidence in the facility's ability or intention to pay on current contractual obligation. Either the minister isn't accurate or the ministry is not accurate. Is the premier okay with her minister making things up as he goes?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, imagine if you were renovating your house. Would you tell the contractor the amount of money that you're going to be paying them? Or would you actually ask the contractor to assess it and negotiate with that contractor? This is precisely the same issue. So why would we identify hospitals and the amount of money that we believe is required to renovate or maintain? We would actually create a transparent, appropriate bidding process where contractors would bid on the replacement or they'd bid on the repairs. It's no different than what you would do for your own house, let alone the fact that when we look at deferred maintenance, what we're talking about is what would be required to restore those hospital facilities to their brand new status. In fact, almost all of the hospitals, because they do this on a go-forward basis, it may be that at some time in the future they need to replace a generator. It may be that they have to replace a building that suits a different need.
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker. These are the sorts of things we're looking at.
Yes. Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, the data that we have is about health and safety. It is about code compliance. It is about imminent breakdown. But yet, although we have the amount, we have no idea which hospital we're talking about. The government-owned data shows that hospitals are overcrowded. The government-owned data shows that hospitals are in desperate need of repair, $3.2 billion worth of repairs. And the government-owned budget shows that hospital funding is not keeping up with inflation, is not keeping up with growing population. And yesterday, the Ontario Health Coalition reported that 94,000 people took the time to call on the Liberal government to stop cutting hospital care. When will the Premier listen to Ontario and stop the cuts to our hospitals?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we are doing precisely what they're asking. We are increasing funding to our hospitals, $345 million this year. The third party voted against our budget, which had that allocation. They voted against our budget that allocated $1 billion more to the health care budget, $52 billion that we invest, Mr. Speaker. They voted against a provision in the budget that doubles the amount that we allocate to deferred maintenance from $50 million a year to $100 million a year. If this was such an important issue to them, Mr. Speaker, if it wasn't just some political partisan spin that they're trying to use here, if it was so important, why didn't they support it in the budget when it doubled the amount of money, the amount of funding that would have gone to deferred maintenance?
Thank you. New question, the member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question to the Premier. Saying that the sell-off of Hydro One will build transit isn't true. Yeah. And anyone who says so is more interested in political spin than facts. Will the Premier stop the sell-off of Hydro One?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, we've been very clear that building infrastructure, including transit, but transportation infrastructure around the province, Mr. Speaker, is a priority. It's a cornerstone of our economic plan, Mr. Speaker. That building is happening, and part of that, Mr. Speaker, which we ran on, was looking at the assets that are owned by the people of Ontario and leveraging those assets to invest in new assets, Mr. Speaker. That's what we're doing with Hydro One, and those investments are going to benefit people across the province, including the people in the riding that the member represents.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, yesterday was Hydro One's first private annual general meeting. The sell-off of Hydro One slashes provincial revenue. It will cause the deficit to skyrocket. It will mean hydro rates will go up. When the Liberals try and suggest otherwise, they're insulting the intelligence of everyone in this province. Will the Premier stop the sell-off of Hydro One?
I honestly think what insults the intelligence of people in this province is a party that suggests that they can do everything, including building transportation infrastructure, and no way to fund it, Mr. Speaker. Absolutely no plan, absolutely no indication of how they would fund any of the things that they suggest, Mr. Speaker. No understanding of how business works, as the questions around the hospitals indicate, Mr. Speaker. No understanding of what it costs to build transit and transportation infrastructure in every corner of this province. That insults the intelligence of people in this province, Mr. Speaker. What we've brought forward is a realistic plan that actually gets shovels in the ground, rail on the roads, Mr. Speaker, and expands transportation across this province.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, selling Hydro One is about one thing and one thing only. It's about the Premier getting a one-time check from shareholders so the books will look good in the next provincial election. That's what it's about. It's bad energy policy, it's bad environmental policy, it's bad economic policy, and everybody knows it. Speaker, will the government admit that they have made a mistake? Will they recognize that they've made a mess of the energy system in this province? And will they stop the sell-off of Hydro One?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
The reminder you're going to get is not going to be helpful. Premier.
I said Minister of Finance.
Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Premier. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's all about creating greater value for the people of Ontario. The members opposite have failed to recognize that by enhancing the value of this corporation, which is now more valuable than it was before, we still retain, at this point, 70% ownership of that company. We made a commitment that we will always be the largest shareholder.
Finish, please.
We will always be the largest shareholder. We will not allow any other person or company to have more than 10%. The issue of foregone revenue that the member speaks of is the fact that we are reinvesting it in other projects and other assets to gain even greater value.
Exactly.
Furthermore, the company is now going to produce even more value and greater dividends for the province, even with the lower ownership. Mr. Speaker, the people of Ontario continue to own this corporation, and the people of Ontario will benefit as we proceed forward.
New question. The member from Charlottetown.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Premier, last week I hosted a town hall on natural gas with over 150 residents in attendance. They want answers. Municipalities have stated they will mobilize against this radical agenda if the government wants to go ahead with its leaked plan. In my riding of Chatham, Kent, Essex, and across the province, thousands of jobs depend on natural gas industry. They need and deserve certainty. So, Speaker, is the Premier amending the building code to phase out natural gas?
Here, here. That's the question.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, we've repeated often in this House, Mr. Speaker, we have in a 2016 budget $230 million to invest in expanding natural gas to rural communities, Mr. Speaker. We also have seen changes in the Ontario Energy Board regulatory framework, Mr. Speaker, that makes it easier to expand natural gas, Mr. Speaker. Union Gas at the present time has 5 applications before the Ontario Energy Board to expand natural gas, Mr. Speaker.
The member from Huron, Bruce, is warned. Finish, please.
Mr. Speaker, they have 5 applications before the Ontario Energy Board. They're working with over a dozen other rural municipalities, Mr. Speaker, to expand natural gas into rural communities, Mr. Speaker.
Answer.
So they just don't want to admit we are investing in rural communities like they never even thought of, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Changing the building code. They're changing the building code.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the Premier. Speaker, the Premier's refusal to answer basic questions is a betrayal of the people she once swore to serve. As a matter of fact, Speaker, the people of Ontario worry about how the Premier is spending billions of their dollars to travel the world to build her own climate change legacy. Here's what the President of the Canadian Gas Association, Timothy Egan, said with regards to the Premier's agenda, and I quote, "Incredibly irresponsible. It will destroy a proud industry, kill countless jobs, ruin families, and drive heating costs through the roof." Our offices get numerous calls each day about natural gas. People have been scared for weeks because this government is too scared to release the real details. MPPs can't do their jobs and provide answers.
Question.
Speaker, why does Premier Wynne continue to turn her back on rural Ontario, ignore their questions? Are you or are you not amending the building code?
Mr. Speaker, once again, the opposition don't want to accept the realities, Mr. Speaker. The reality that they're accepting, Mr. Speaker, is a draft document that was leaked to the media, Mr. Speaker. They accept it as fact, Mr. Speaker. So in the coming weeks, Mr. Speaker, there will be a fulsome climate change action plan in place, Mr. Speaker, and then they can respond. Then we can have the conversation. Mr. Speaker, we have done more consultation with the gas sector probably than any other sector as we lead up to this over the last year and a half or 2 years, Mr. Speaker. They have an open door to—
The member from Prince Edward Hastings is warned. Wrap up, please.
Speaker, we're expanding natural gas, particularly into rural communities, Mr. Speaker. Right. That's a reality they don't want to accept, and it upsets them to see.
Thank you. New question, the member from Oshawa.
Thank you, Speaker, and my question is to the Premier. New Democrats support a strong public pension plan. We believe that all Ontarians should be able to retire with dignity. This government, however, has— This government, however, has taken it upon itself to exclude thousands, if not millions, of Ontarians and their families. This month, the provinces are set to discuss a potential increase to the Canada Pension Plan, a plan that leaves no Canadian behind. Speaker, even the federal government has expressed concerns that the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan, which currently leaves out thousands of workers, may prevent a future CPP enhancement. Premier, will the government support a universal enhancement to the Canada Pension Plan so that every Canadian can benefit?
Social Minister of Finance.
Social Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Speaker. And I want to thank the member opposite for her question. I know that she's been the critic on this particular file, and the member opposite knows full well that Ontario has provided strong leadership when it comes to retirement security in this province. And that leadership, Speaker, is something that is moving us forward as we look to implement the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. Mr. Speaker, we have consulted very widely on this policy, and we've received input from all sides, from business, from
the member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek is warned. I would have gotten the message long ago. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we are creating a secure retirement savings floor for the people of Ontario so that when they retire, they can retire with dignity. Our Premier, our Minister of Finance, in fact, have led national conversations when it comes to the expansion of CPP, Mr. Speaker, and we are currently at the table. We remain at the table as we build a stronger retirement system here in Ontario.
Thank you, Speaker. During committee this week, New Democrats called, as always, for a universal Ontario pension plan, but the government voted down each and every one of our amendments. This Liberal government believes that only some workers in Ontario should be allowed to participate in the ORPP. Canadians pride themselves on having a public health care system, a public education system, and a public pension system that benefits us all. Speaker, it's part of who we are as Canadians. Now, however, it looks like the Liberals' design of the Ontario pension plan may jeopardize a future CPP enhancement. Premier, does this government actually believe that it has the mandate to redesign the CPP?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, our government believes that after a lifetime of working, Ontarians deserve to retire with dignity and with security. And that is what we're building. And we are moving forward, Mr. Speaker, with the implementation of the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. We are at the table as conversations are underway with the CPP expansion. And those discussions, we've always said, will take time, and we're part of that conversation. Mr. Speaker, what is important is that when people retire, that they have a predictable stream of income in retirement, and that is exactly what they will have with the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. It will bring financial security. It will ensure that when people retire, Mr. Speaker, they can do so with dignity and that they have that lifetime income, Mr. Speaker. And that's to ensure that, in fact, when our young workers retire, that they will have retirement security that they don't have today.
New question, the member from Ottawa South.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Labour. Today, June 1st, marks the 33rd annual Injured Workers Day. And as the Minister reminded us a few weeks ago in the House, despite our progress, too many people continue to lose their lives, suffer an injury or an illness simply because they went to work. No job is worth a life. No job is worth an injury. I know every year the Minister of Labour addresses injured workers and their representatives when they assemble here. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please share with us what we're doing to improve the lives of injured workers and treating them with the respect and dignity they deserve?
Thank you, Minister of Labour.
Thank you, Speaker, and thanks to the honourable member for that excellent question. I want to also take this opportunity to thank all the groups that have come down to visit us here, as they do on an annual basis at Queen's Park. And Speaker, on this issue, prevention is key. But when that prevention simply isn't working, Speaker, and injuries occur and fatalities occur, those that are injured need to know that they're going to be treated with dignity and they're going to be treated with respect.
Absolutely.
And, Speaker, we should be proud in the province of Ontario. We've come a long way. The province's annual rate of workplace injuries has dropped by more than 40% in the past decade.
Remarkable.
We should be proud of that, Speaker, but we shouldn't be satisfied for 1 minute with that. There's a long way to go, Speaker. We shouldn't rest as long as one person is injured on the job. Speaker, I'm proud of the government's record in this regard, but not satisfied, Speaker. There's a long way to go. We've got a number of plans in place. I look forward to meeting the injured workers today.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I'd like to thank the minister for that response. And I was pleased to join him earlier this year when we opened an office to assist injured workers in Ottawa. And we all know that many workplace incidents can be prevented. Workplace injuries should never just be seen as a cost of doing business. It's important that Ontario has a workplace culture that protects workers and prevents injuries from happening in the first place. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, what steps are we taking to ensure that our loved ones and friends return home safe after a day of work? Thank you.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you once again to the member for that excellent question. Speaker, we're working very hard at the ministry with partners right around this province to keep the injury numbers down and to eliminate deaths. Speaker, we've almost doubled the number of workplace inspectors in the province of Ontario that look at health and safety. We've increased the amount of health and safety training that is now mandatory in the province of Ontario.
Excellent.
Every single worker in this province, Speaker, must take basic health and safety training before they enter the workforce. We've got mandatory specialized training for those people that work at Heights. Speaker, since last April, 100,000 Ontarians have taken that training at working at Heights. Workers that are new to their job, including young workers, this is so important, Speaker. Young workers are three times more likely to be heard on the job than older workers, Speaker. We need to concentrate on that. At the Ministry of Labour, we're doing exactly that.
Answer.
I'd ask all members to spread that message through their own constituency offices about the importance of health and safety.
Thank you. New question. The member from Huron Bruce.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Environment Minister. Speaker, I am sure you have seen the news that California and Quebec's recent cap-and-trade auction flopped. In fact, only 11% of the allowances were actually sold. Now, California is scrambling to make up for this funding shortfall. Still, the Environment Minister actually told TVO yesterday he isn't worried about similar problems in Ontario, even though the government has promised to spend $1.2 billion in cap-and-trade funds on a laundry list of Liberal pet projects without even raising a dime. The Liberals are spending money they don't have. So, Speaker, how will the government cover the tab for the Liberals' billion-dollar spending spree if Ontario's first cap-and-trade auction crashes just like California and Quebec's did?
Stop the clock. The member from Tourism, Culture and Sport is warned. You want to gamble? Premier.
It was me.
Sorry. Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question from the member opposite. This is a market system. There are periods. We've had over a dozen auctions now that where they were oversubscribed. The last one was 95%. This was lower. At different points in the compliance period, there will be greater or lesser demand. We are early and far away from the end of the next compliance period. We expect fluctuations, Mr. Speaker. It is a market mechanism. It is not a politicized system, and it works on supply and demand, which last time I looked was a fairly consistent principle with conservatives who like markets and like the market to solve problems. So we're using a market mechanism that is working all around the world, Mr. Speaker, and within the next 12 months, over half the world's economy will be covered by a carbon pricing system, the vast majority of it, the cap and trade system that we're talking
about.
Japan, China, Germany, Britain, California, Mr. Speaker. It's a market. It will go up and down. We have confidence in markets.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Back to the minister. The truth is, the minister is planning on funding shortfalls, and he said so. He actually told TVO yesterday, and I quote, "We know in the early years, until the market is mature, you'll see more dramatic swings." Speaker, I find it unbelievable that the Liberals are willing to write billion-dollar checks without knowing how much money they'll have in the bank. With no contingency plan in place, the Liberals will once again leave Ontarians with either more debt or more taxes. So, Speaker, I ask the minister to be clear with the people of Ontario today. Are the Liberals going to plunge Ontario deeper into debt or raise taxes to cover the funding shortfall after their first cap-and-trade auction crashes?
Or both. Minister of the Environment.
So, Mr. Speaker, if you needed more proof that all of this money was going to reduce greenhouse gas and for environmental programs, here's your proof. The money is dedicated to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. It is a market system. Money comes in transparently based on how much comes in at each auction. It goes out, it will be independently reviewed, and it is spent transparently on greenhouse gas emissions. In the years that the market generates more revenue, there will be more revenue spent. And this is the difference. This money is going to programs the cement industry wants, homeowners want. It's going to lower heating costs. It's going to help people buy low-carbon vehicles. It's going to make major investments in our auto sector to modernize and continue to support a dynamic auto sector. Liberals have the money to invest in the auto sector. Tories consistently vote against the auto sector.
Thank you.
I stand, you sit. New question, the member from Windsor-Tecumseh.
Thank you, Speaker. My question's for the Premier. Good morning, Premier. Today we're joined by hundreds of individuals and families and they've suffered an injury or illness at work and have been felt let down by the Liberal government's mismanagement of our province's workers' compensation system. The WSIB is supposed to protect our province's most vulnerable. Instead, over the past 6 years, the Liberal government has been too concerned with bringing down WSIB's $12 million debt and doing so at the cost of those who depend on their benefits to make ends meet. Speaker, when will this Liberal government stop retiring the WSIB's unfunded liability on the backs of injured workers and their families?
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member from Windsor-Tecumseh for this very important question and for the courtesy he extended me prior to this question. Speaker, all injured workers deserve to be treated with dignity and respect. When those injuries occur, Speaker, we wish they didn't occur, and we do everything we possibly can to make sure they don't. When they do occur, people should expect to be treated, as I said, with dignity and respect. So, Speaker, we've been working with the WSIB, I think, in a very progressive way. Just earlier this year, we passed legislation that established the indexation of WSIB benefits to full CPI. We're going to index benefits that, oddly enough, Speaker, were taken away 19 years ago by the very members' same party.
Oh!
We've reinstated them. Speaker, we listened to the concerns. Part of that respect, part of that dignity is to make sure we understand the concerns of injured workers. That's why today is so important. What we've done in Bill 109, Speaker, is focus very clearly and precisely on the rights of injured workers in this province. Speaker, we'll continue to do that.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, if life was as good as the minister makes it sound, we wouldn't have hundreds of people on the lawn today saying this is not the case. The truth is, under the Liberal government's watch, those who suffer an injury at work and go to the WSIB for help get attacked on all fronts, including reduced claims, premature return to work, ignoring the advice of medical professionals, and that list goes on and on and on. Amwar Pierre, who was at the rally at Queen's Park today, is a father with a torn rotator cuff from a picking job received through a temp agency. He's unable to work, and he struggles to make ends meet because the WSIB has disagreed with his doctor. Speaker, I'll ask again, when will this government stop retiring WSIB's debts on the backs of Anwar and our province's most vulnerable workers?
Thank you. Minister.
Be seated, please.
Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you once again to the member from Windsor-Tecumseh. He raises a very important question. And, Speaker, that's precisely why this House passed Bill 109, simply to focus on improving protections for workers in this province. Speaker, we changed the way that we calculate survivor benefits. We made it an offence now for employers to prevent workers from reporting workplace injuries and illnesses. We've increased the maximum corporate penalty, Speaker, from $100,000 to $500,000. We put in a fair practices commissioner, Speaker, to investigate when people have an issue with the WSIB, they have an ombud to go to, Speaker. It's that simple. You listen to injured workers, you act on their concerns, you make the system work for them. That's exactly what we're doing, Speaker. I'll be proud today to stand before those hundreds of injured workers and talk about the track record of this government, Speaker. It's second to none. This government respects injured workers. This government will ensure that there's practices in place to make sure they get the respect and the dignity that they receive when they need services from the WSIB.
Thank you. New question, the member from Beaches East York.
Well, thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Environment and Climate Change. Now, diverting waste from landfill is an incredibly important issue that many generations of governments, many government paths have grappled with. Quite frankly, we just produce far too much waste. We don't recycle enough. And prior to me assuming my role here as the member for Beaches East York, I worked closely with the recycling industry to expand the materials collected in the Blue Box to include box board, wrapping paper, used books. And I also worked with a team of people at the beverage industry, the alcoholic industry, in order to bring the deposit system to liquor bottles and material, thus taking material out of the Blue Box. The problem, Speaker, is it becomes very problematic. Who gets to pay for what's in the Blue Box? And that's why we brought in Bill 151. And I know, Speaker, that during the course of our hearings, 5 days and clause by clause, we heard numerous submissions from people across the province about how to improve Bill 151. So I'd like to ask the Minister, Ministry of Environment and Climate Change, if he could explain to this House the improvements we made to the bill to serve Ontario better.
Thank you, Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Thanks, Mr. Speaker. I also just want to give a shout out to the member for Renfrew-Nipissing Pembroke, Mr. Speaker, who I heard earlier speaking in memorial. He did a lovely job. And at that spirit of nonpartisanship, that when we get it in the House is a good thing. And this bill is an example of that, Mr. Speaker. Members from all three parties worked very hard on this together. And I want to give credit to the member for Huron-Bruce and the member for Toronto-Danforth and many other members here on both sides of the House. This is an excellent bill. It will, the work we did with AMIL will relieve about $117 million in municipal costs. The work we did with Unilever, I want to thank John Coyne and Bob Chant, will actually make this much more efficient and more cost-effective for business, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member from Minister for Environment and Climate Change for his excellent work on this file. This has been extremely important that we are listening to parties and representatives on all sides of the House to bring together the best bill we can for waste diversion in Ontario. So this input has been very critical, but I'd also like to shout out to the member for Mississauga Brampton South, who shepherded the bill through committee, who was extremely important in drawing out some of the commentary in order to ensure that we got all the nuanced stuff right in order to make this bill as good as possible. So the bill is intended to improve resource efficiency and have the right people in the right place pay for and do the work. And so that's why we know that just recovering 60% of the waste materials could generate upwards of 13,000 jobs and contribute over $1.5 billion to gross domestic
product.
So will the minister then speak to how this bill can affect the people in the province on a daily basis and help us improve our diversion rate from landfill?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for his support. I also want to thank the member for Mississauga Brampton South, who did an excellent job. She's got a sharp mind for this. And to the member for Sudbury, who stole all my bow ties, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this is a remarkable piece of economic work, and I want to thank the Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure. This is going to help us improve productivity. For example, we collect enough aluminum in Ontario and Quebec to run an aluminum smelter entirely on recovered materials. That means it would only use 5% of the energy it does from virgin materials. Three of our steel mills work entirely on recovered materials. These are huge productivity gains that reduce structural costs in the Ontario economy, and the synergies of this all-in-government approach of not seeing the environment is hostile to the economy, but seeing one contributing positively the other. And I want to thank the Premier and my colleagues for taking this all-inclusive approach, integrating economic and environmental policy. I want to thank the opposition parties for working so closely with us and providing real leadership, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
And a question to the member from Prince Edward Hastings.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question this morning is for the Premier. It happened earlier this year for fans of Adele, and even prior to that, for fans of Springsteen. This week it happened again as there was a huge outcry from music fans. It's been deafening, actually. Fans of the Tragically Hip who went online to buy tickets, and those tickets were snatched up in just seconds after they went on sale. What those fans probably didn't know, however, was that last July this government changed the ticket resale laws to make it easier for big ticket sellers to gouge customers. For years, these corporate giants have been going to legislatures around the world trying to change scalping laws so that they can turn the screws on consumers. And last summer, you eliminated the last protection for consumers that there was. Speaker, what possible reason could the government have for abandoning music fans and concertgoers here in Ontario?
Thank you.
Attorney General.
General.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First of all, you know, I feel sorry for those fans of the Tragically Hip who wanted to go to concert and have to pay, you know, these prices. And so, I, you know, in 2010, Ontario amended the Ticket Speculation Act to add additional protection to consumers from unfair ticket reselling practice. So the amendment prohibited related primary ticket seller and secondary ticket seller, including broker and agent, from selling tickets to the same event. The amendment was aimed at ensuring that those who profit from the sale of tickets on the primary market may not also profit from the resale of the secondary market. You know, we did that. It's a complicated explanation to say, you know, to prevent this from happening.
Answer.
But, you know, like it seems like the technology is always ahead. And I said, you know, we're going to do what we can to prevent this.
Thank you. Supplementary.
So it's okay then to rip off consumers if it's online,
no, it's not.
But not face to face, according to this government. Late breaking story on the CBC, Mr. Speaker. For 91 years, it's been illegal in Ontario to sell tickets above face value until last summer. And at that time, the government changed the law. John Karastamatis of Mervish Productions said this change catered to big ticket holders like Ticketmaster, StubHub, and MLSE. Quote, "That's what this new law was all about, to allow these corporations to be able to legally use the same techniques that the so-called street scalpers use." If Ontario music fans want to know what really happened, I've got 52,700 reasons why this happened. That's how much Ticketmaster and its parent company have donated to the Ontario Liberals in the last 2 years. Speaker, why did Ticketmaster end up like the Leafs winning the Cup in 62 and Ontario?
Minister.
They won it in 1967.
The Minister of Consumer Services.
Thank you, Speaker. And the amount of time that's left doesn't bother me at all, and anyone else that wants to speak out. All right, the member from Eglinton Lawrence is warned, and the member from Renfrew Nipissing Pembroke is warned. Anyone else? I'm getting close to being able to name some. And I'm not going to stop. Minister of Government and Consumer Services.
Thank you, Speaker. And I want to clarify a couple of things here that the member has raised with respect to this issue. There was a regulation change July 1st, 2015. One of the fundamental issues that was at the heart of this was the fraud that was taking place with systems that were not able to be verified and people getting tickets that were...
Excuse me. A member from Leeds Granville is warned. I'm going to pass the test. Carry on.
Thank you, Speaker. And so what was done was the important change that was made that allows companies to resell those tickets on the original site with guarantees. The government does not set ticket prices for the public and for concerts. That's determined by the marketplace, as most would agree, what people will pay for them. Our concern around protecting
Answer.
Consumers is with respect to the fraud that was taking place and the validity of the tickets to ensure that an individual actually purchased an authentic ticket.
Thank you. Good question, the member from Cronulla, Rainy River.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Premier. Speaker, quote, "In the spirit of reconciliation, the Ontario government should do the right thing," end quote, and clean up the Wabagoon River system and Clay Lake. That wasn't the NDP that said this, even though we've repeatedly raised the issue of the legacy of mercury contamination of the Grassy Narrows First Nation territory with this government. That was Ontario Regional Chief Isidore Day. Quote, "No single act would go further to illustrate that a new era has dawned in our relationship with Indigenous peoples and our shared environment," end quote, Dr. David Suzuki. Quote, "Efforts to remediate the mercury have been postponed long enough," end quote. That's the Liberal MP for Dryden and the former Indian Affairs Federal Minister, Bob Nault. Speaker, when will this government do what everyone knows needs to be done and clean up the Wabagoon River so that the people of Grassy Narrows may fish and live off their land without becoming sick?
Question. Thank you. Premier.
Aboriginal Affairs.
Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, as you know, this report was released the other day.
It is with the Ministry of the Environment and Climate Change. My office received a copy yesterday. My office is reviewing the report, as is the Ministry of the Environment and Climate Change. The report suggests new science. This government is always interested in the best science available, the newest science available. We will consider the science suggestions, the recommendations in the report, after our experts have had a chance to review the report, and would have a comment later on it. Thank you.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, 2 days ago, the same day the Premier apologized for the province's role in the legacy of residential schools, the Premier said that she hadn't read the report that her government has had since April. And now we hear from the Ministry of Aboriginal Affairs that they've only received the report yesterday. This is ridiculous. Yesterday, the Premier said that she had read the report, but she claimed that the solutions that were proposed in there weren't clear. So let me be clear, because the report is very clear. Determine whether there is an ongoing mercury leak. Find out if there are hot spots that carry contaminated mercury downriver. Inject clay into the river to enhance the natural remediation that's going on. It has been done effectively in other parts of the province, such as Sudbury, decades ago. We know that it can be done. So, Speaker, let me ask this. Why won't this Premier commit to cleaning up the Wabagoon River of its mercury contamination that's making the people in Grassy Narrows sick?
Minister.
Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Thank you. The Minister of
Environment
and Climate Change.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, very much. Not only has the Premier read it, she's instructed me and the Minister of Indigenous Relations of Aboriginal Affairs, soon to be something even more exciting. So, Mr. Speaker, the report is being reviewed right now. It's been read by myself and the Premier. We take it very seriously. It's not a simple report. It asks for determination of sources, which is complex. There's issues of sediment. There is issues of the fact that the Dryden plant doesn't use mercury anymore, and there are still potentially other sources, and there's a complex set of issues in Clay Lake. Chief Isidore Day and I meet every 2 weeks. We met yesterday. We had a lengthy discussion about that. He's proposing some ideas. He's working with Grassy Narrows First Nation. We will be moving very quickly on this, but everyone agrees more research to determine which of the interventions suggested and which combination are the best, and we're going to get to the bottom of it, and I'll work with you to ensure we work together on that.
Thank you. New question. The member from Etobicoke North.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you. My question is for the minister responsible for long-term care and the promotion of well-being.
World No Tobacco Day, an important milestone across the globe and an opportunity for us to consider the impact of tobacco on Ontarians. Doctors know that smoking is a universal evil, heightening the risk of heart attack, stroke, poor leg circulation, emphysema, and multiple cancers. I'm grateful, in fact, that our government has made it a priority to educate Ontarians and to provide supports for those looking to quit. For example, the Smoke-Free Ontario strategy has greatly reduced tobacco use and lowered health risks to non-smokers in Ontario. In addition, the government has made many contributions inspired by community organizations, public health units, and outspoken individuals who have worked tirelessly to promote a smoke-free culture. Speaker, my question is this. Would the minister please update this House on the government's Smoke-Free Ontario initiative?
Associate Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Speaker. I want to thank the member from Etobicoke North, who I know as a physician is a great advocate for this issue, and I want to thank him for all of his advocacy. As we all know, 2016 marks the 10th anniversary of the Smoke-Free Ontario Act. Through this act and through our work with various contributing organizations, our government has significantly reduced tobacco use in Ontario. As a result of this important work, smoking rates in Ontario have decreased from 24.5% in 2000 to 17.4% in 2014, which represents 400,000 fewer smokers. Speaker, that's 400,000 lives saved. Our strategy focuses on prevention, protection, and cessation, and we've invested over $336 million in this strategy since 2008. And more importantly, Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to announce that in our recent budget, we committed to a funding increase of $5 million for smoking cessation.
Thank you. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, for your leadership on this file on the Smoke-Free Ontario strategy. I know that important work, of course, lies ahead in our efforts to make Ontario the jurisdiction with the lowest smoking rates in Canada. The Minister's focus on protection and enforcement, prevention, cessation, all will have important impacts in the lives of both non-smokers suffering secondhand smoke as well as smokers who are looking to quit. Speaker, yesterday the Minister celebrated the 10th anniversary of Smoke-Free Ontario at an event that recognized contributions of anti-tobacco champions across the province. And while she spoke to the attendees about the need to refresh and update all three pillars of the Smoke-Free Ontario strategy, she also made important commitments to providing new cessation supports for Ontario's priority populations. Speaker, through you to the Minister, can the Associate Minister of Health and Long-Term Care please inform the House about the smoking cessation supports this government is providing for all Ontarians?
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. And again, once again, thank the member from Etobicoke North for the question. And I know he, as a physician, again, he'll be delighted with some of the changes we are making as we move forward with a new cessation action plan. This plan includes the establishment of an online cessation hub that is a centralized access point to help tobacco users navigate the system and to find local services and cessation aids tailored to their needs. And this will be in place by summer of 2017. A centralized access point to help tobacco users find local services. And starting by the next quit season, Mr. Speaker, I am so pleased to announce that we will be providing one quit line phone number available to all Ontarians 24/7, which will offer coaching and counseling to help smokers quit. We have a number of cessation service network of coordinated support.
Answer.
And we look forward to enhancing these. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. The member from Haldimand Norfolk.
Speaker, to the Minister of Health, a year ago this legislature enacted a private member's bill to create a provincial framework and an action plan concerning vector-borne and zoonotic diseases, diseases like Lyme. The law mandates the framework and the action plan within a year of when it was passed. Obviously, the year is now up. Will the Minister please outline to this House and to people affected by diseases like Lyme, the required plan to take action?
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And we have a Lyme reference group, which is comprised of stakeholders on this issue, that is working towards issuing a strategy together with the provincial government. We're working on a broader strategy as well. But I appreciate getting a health question because I feel compelled to address an issue that was raised by one of the member's colleagues earlier this week about the cancer care clinic in North Bay, Mr. Speaker. And I'm compelled to because this involves individuals and families who are suffering from cancer, who have been shaken because of a rumour that was started by the member from Nipissing. And the rumour began with him and was promulgated by him. And there was no truth to it, Mr. Speaker. And the president of North Bay Hospital, as well as the head of the cancer clinic, had to come forward and publicly deny that there was absolutely...
Come to order, please. Come to order. People are taking a risk. There are votes today. Please finish. You have a wrap-up.
Mr. Speaker, this is so important to the public interest. The member from Nipissing didn't bother to call the hospital, didn't bother to call the cancer clinic, didn't bother to talk to me. He promulgated a rumor which he knew was untrue.
Thank
and
you.
It's the crisis.
I know my job. The member will withdraw.
I withdraw.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Minister, I do ask you to come back to this issue, the deadline for action on Lyme. Received an email from a mother of a Lyme victim, and I quote, "People of Ontario need to know that our health care is like living in a third world country," end quote. Minister, people continue to go to the States for Lyme disease testing for treatment. We want to know, what is Ontario now doing as legislated to help these people? What's been done with respect to testing? What's been done with respect to treatment, to prevention, surveillance? What new approaches, we've had a year, do we now see with respect to education and research? The tick season, the mosquito season, is now upon us. And, Minister, I sincerely ask you, what has been put in place? Thank you.
Thank you, Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And the issue of Lyme disease and the broader strategy as well for dealing with similar zoonotic diseases that are prevalent in this province. It's an issue that's extremely important to me as a public health doctor. It's extremely important to the ministry. We're working hard. We have a reference group that is comprised of many stakeholders. Mr. Speaker, I want to commend as well the member from Algoma, Manitoulin. I'll be meeting with him next week, I believe, and a number of stakeholders specifically on the issue of Lyme disease, and I want to commend him for his proactive work and advocacy on this issue. It's extremely important. We have a reference group which is doing their hard work, which is working towards updating our strategy, our provincial strategy. And, Mr. Speaker, I won't be satisfied until we have a strategy that reflects the best clinical guidelines and best evidence and science available so we can provide individuals that are at risk of or suffering from Lyme disease, whether that's acute or chronic,
where
they get the best possible care in this province than they could get.
Thank you. The member from Windsor-Tecumseh on a point of order.
Mr. Speaker, I stand to correct my record. Earlier today, I said the unfunded liability at the WSIB was $12 million. We know the unfunded liability, the unfunded debt load at the WSIB is $12 billion.
Thank you. The Minister of Finance on a point of order.
Mr. Speaker, I beg your indulgence. This is not an introduction, which I missed earlier today, and I appreciate the order that you provided yesterday. I just wanted to congratulate today our page captain, Julia Michaud, who's doing a great job. And I just want.
I'm sorry, that's not acceptable. Thank you. Minister of Haldimand Norfolk on a point of order.
Speaker, I recognize it is after 12 o'clock. Could I ask for a special dispensation for a late show on the recent question?
Members consent. The member from Haldimand Norfolk is correct that afternoon, after the hour of noon, it needs request for a unanimous consent to issue a late show. Therefore, on behalf of the member from Haldimand Norfolk, seeking unanimous consent to put forward a late show. Do we agree? I heard a no. The Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Mr. Speaker, earlier when I was speaking to the issue of deferred maintenance in hospitals, I had erroneously indicated — this is a point of order, Mr. Speaker — I had erroneously indicated that that the annual spending on deferred maintenance by my ministry is $100 million. In fact, the annual spending on deferred maintenance from my ministry is $175 million annually.
Okay.
And, I would also take this moment to simply say to you, I will be strict on what I told you yesterday. I do not want any tricks being played. We are not going to do this anymore. We're going to simply say introductions are done during those two times in which you're allowed to introduce, and I'm staying firm with that, as are my deputy speakers. We have a deferred vote on the motion of third reading of Bill 100, an act to enact the Ontario Trails Act 2016 to amend various acts. Calling the members, this will be a five-minute bill.
All members, please take your seats. On May 31st, 2016, Mr. Coteau moved third reading of Bill 100. All those in favor, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayeur.
Madame Mayeur.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Darmerla.
Ms. Darmerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidoo Harris.
Ms. Naidoo Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Reneal.
Ms. Reneal.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Miller Perry Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantal.
Mr. Vantal.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Nadishak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gelinas.
Madame Gelinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Gretzky.
Mr. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
The nays are 3.
Wow. The ayes being 92 and the nays being 3, I declare the motion carried.
You have the bill. Troisième lecture, projet de loi.
Be it resolved that the bill do now pass and be entitled as in the motion. We have a deferred vote on the motion of closure of the motion of third reading of Bill 151, an act to enact Resource Recovery and Circular Economy Act 2015 and the Waste Division Transition Act 2015, and to repeal the Waste Diversion Act 2002. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell. On May 17, 2016, Ms. Magna moved the third reading of Bill 151, an act to enact the Resource Recovery and Circular Economy Act 2015 and the Waste Diversion Transition Act 2015 and to repeal the Waste Diversion Act of 2002. Mr. Cole has moved that the question be now put. All those in favour of Mr. Cole's motion, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandel.
Ms. Sandel.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassic.
Ms. Jassic.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidoo Harris.
Ms. Naidoo Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Reneal.
Mr. Tebow.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound, Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound, Muskoka.
Mr. McNaught.
Mr. McNaught.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Nadeshak.
Mr. Nadeshak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gelina.
Madame Gelina.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Monsieur Montat.
Monsieur Montat.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
The ayes are 53, the nays are 41.
The ayes being 53 and the nays being 41, I declare the motion carried. Ms. Magnet has moved third reading of Bill 151, an act to enact the Resource Recovery and Circular Economy Act 2015 and the Waste Diversion Transition Act of 2015 and to repeal the Waste Diversion Act of 2002. Is it the pleasure of the House the motion carry? I heard a no. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. In my opinion, the ayes have it. The ayes have it. De carry. Be it resolved that the bill be now passed and entitled in the motion. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until. Oh, sorry. The member from Haldimand Norfolk on a point of order.
Order, Speaker. Could I ask unanimous consent for a late show on the Lyme disease question?
Being afternoon, the member from Haldimand Norfolk is seeking unanimous consent to have a late show. Do we agree?
Agreed.
Agreed. There are no further. The member from Nipissing on a point of order.
Speaker, I stand on a point of order. Yesterday during question period, I spoke of a rumour in the city of North Bay. It turns out it's not a rumour, it was a fact.
Thank you. That's not a point of order, and the member should know so. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.